tiny yet, huh? I have to, this is not, I have to go there because I cannot see well. Okay. So I'm not going to greet anyone. All right. Biodiversity. Biodiversity is life. It's a different flora and fauna that make this planet come alive. It's fresh air, it's food, it's water. Without biodiversity, the planet would look like the moon. 70% of the biodiversity of the entire planet is found in 17 very, very blessed mega diversity countries. The Philippines is one of them. We are not only one of the 17 mega diversity countries, we are also number one in endemicity. What's endemicity? Endemicity is when the flora and the fauna cannot be found anywhere else in the world, only here. And per unit area, we're number one. Now we take this in context of an island ecosystem, because I'm not against the whole mining industry, but I am just saying in an island in an island ecosystem where there's mountains and forests and mangroves and coral reefs and farmlands, you know, it's an interweave of ecological systems. It's very different from Canada or Australia with huge tracts of land. This is an interweave of ecological systems where biodiversity thrives. My stand is that in an island ecosystem, whether large scale or small scale, mining is grossly irresponsible. So maybe you'll take back your claps. No? Okay, let's look at the biodiversity. This is the biodiversity that was plotted. My timing is okay. This is the biodiversity that was plotted by Conservation International. Okay, and this red thing here is a mining tenement. How can you have mining in a biodiversity place? Okay, because no amount of reforestation will bring back an ecological system. No amount of planting trees does not replicate an ecological system. Look at this. There's mining tenements in biodiversity areas because, as Mr. Jesereno has said, areas of biodiversity are also rich in mineral resources. So the question is, what choice will we make? And I submit in no uncertain terms that if there's biodiversity and there's rich mineral resources, the choice must always be on the side of biodiversity, because I would like you to know that for the Rio Janeiro summit, the Philippines committed that we would protect our biodiversity at all costs. All right, so then that's... So you take the island ecosystem, and on top of that, you're aware of the fact that as the typhoon circled the planet, the Philippines is the number one typhoon-hit country in the planet. So you have mining in biodiversity areas, and then we have horrendous typhoons. Isn't that too much of a risk? Okay, let's take Palawan. Okay, look at the biodiversity in Palawan. 379 species of corals, 259 species of birds. It's a biodiversity paradise, and you will all agree, because I'm sure many of you have been there. Look at the biodiversity in Palawan. And then look at that. You know what those colored squares are? Mining applications in the very same sites of biodiversity. And yes, they're applications, they're not operations. But that's precisely why we need to come up with a really strong policy, especially in Palawan, that there should not be any mining anymore. So look at these pictures. These are mining roads in the forests of Palawan. That's a violation of the Palawan law. Okay, that's an abandoned mine site. It's been abandoned since the 80s. That's another abandoned mine site. Okay, that, you know, and Jerry, as I said, I really like you and there's nothing personal. But this is Rio Tuba. Okay, and I actually brought a farmer here who said he can remember when there was once lush with forest. Okay, that's Rio Tuba. Okay, and I actually, you know, I wanted to see myself, so I flew over the whole island of Palawan for 2 hours. Okay, and again, Jerry, I really like you, but actually, the incidence of poverty in Batarasa is 53%. It's double the national average. Okay, look at this. That's mining on top of the rice fields. That's mining on top of the rice fields of Palawan. Okay, that's the rice fields that have been disadvantaged, 55 hectares. I took that shot myself with the iPad, and you can see that the mining road is just on top of the rice fields. Okay, look at that. That just happened a few months ago when a Chinese vessel rammed into 979 square meters of corals. Now, you all know it takes thousands of years to form corals. Well, they just destroyed it. Who pays for that? Mining in an island ecosystem should never, never be. Look at this. This is mining on top of the rice fields. That's the sea. That's lateritic soil. You can't grow rice there. And look at this. Oh, somebody has to move there so I can. Okay, look at this. This is a study, and Dr. Lina is here now, where she took samples. So when the mining industry says that mining is not bad for agriculture, I'm going to show them this test. Okay, chromium here, the allowable is 100. Look at that. That's 762. The allowable nickel is 5 to 50. Look at that, 2,820. And the allowable is 50. Where is all this nickel coming from? And look at the iron. The iron is 25,600, and that's 108,000. Okay, then I went to another island. As you can see, I'm now going to many islands. And so I went to this Rapu-Rapu because they told me it's the most tightly monitored mine in the country. So I wanted to see it. So what I saw was an island which was lush, and then I see that. And I said, how can you have mining at the tip of an island in Bicol? My God, you know how horrendous the typhoons are there? And what if what if something happens? I think the very fact of putting mining at the tip of the island is irresponsible. Okay, then that's the corals of Bicol, and that's what happened after the mine spill. Okay, that's a few years back when the tailing pond overflowed, it went to the river, it went to the stream, it went to the river, it went to the sea, and you had a fish kill. Okay, then I went to Manikani, you know, this island in Samar. And I was looking down from the chopper and I looked at that and you know what that is? That's corals. It's gorgeous. We have no idea how amazing our country is. And I saw these corals and then I'm flying nearer the island. And by the way, there's that mining company has an MPSA for the entire island. And around the island is a marine reserve. So I go near there. I mean, okay, so you'd like that, and when I went there, it was raining, and I literally saw with my own eyes this red water going to the sea. And you take it that around the island is a marine reserve? Mining in islands is just too much of a risk. Okay, then I'm going to show you this. This is Surigao. Okay, so you have to make the sound louder. Look at that. The chopper goes on, and just goes on and on and on and on. What's that? Okay, it just looks... I mean, how can this be responsible? And then you look at that, all the silt there. So whatever they say their mining tenement is small, I mean, the impact goes far beyond. Look at that. It's irresponsible. Okay, and then you take, and I think someone here is from Marinduque, because you all know about the Marinduque disaster, where the tailings went to the river, that's acid, where the river has turned acidic, and up to now, that river is biologically dead. It affected the rice fields, look at the health effects. Okay, then I'm going to tell you about Tubai, and I saw Eric here, who's the head of SMI. I said nothing personal, okay, but I'm going to tell you the story of Tubai, and the mayor is here, so you can ask her if I'm telling the truth. So, Tubai is this area where the mayor, the vice mayor, the Sangguniang Bayan, the governor, everyone said, yes, come mine in Tubai, because we're going to have jobs, it's good for the economy. So this is what Tubai looked like before, and that's what Tubai looks like now. Okay, then I asked her, so why did you allow the mining? And she said, Mom, because we wanted the fees. Well, how much are the fees? You know what she told me? For every ton of soil that comes out from Dubai and goes to China, you know how much they get? 25 pesos. 25 pesos? A ton? Okay, then I asked her, how much money did you get the first year? You know what she told me? 44 million pesos. And I was thinking, 44 million pesos and it's 25 pesos. How many tons did they get? So I calculated and it came out to 1.8 million tons. Okay, so the first year she got these 44 million pesos, and because the mining company was using heavy machinery, it upgraded to large-scale mining, which means that the mining company continues to get these tons of soil from Dubai, and the municipality gets zero. Because the money now goes to the national government. Okay, that's what's happening in Dubai. On top of that, they can't use their road. That road was built with municipal funds, and they haven't been able to use that road for several years because it's guarded by the military. Okay, then every time it rains, their roads are filled with red water. Okay, see, look at this. So their coral reefs are, their coral reefs are gone. Their fish sanctuary is gone. And look at this. That purple there is 4 billion pesos. That's the amount of money the mining company makes. And that thin sliver there, that's what Dubai gets. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the law. It's the law. And yet the very source of that 4 billion pesos is that municipality. And that's what they get. Now you tell me, is this fair? And what she gets is roads filled with toxic water, her fish sanctuary gone, she can't use her barangay road, and for all that suffering, that's what she gets. All right, now I want to talk to you about the alternatives. Puerto Princesa, my boast, you know, I really like this place. Okay, Puerto Princesa has said no mining, no logging. They went agriculture, they went tourism. Okay, look at the numbers of Puerto Princesa. From 50 million to over 10 billion. From 7 to 32 banks. From 3 to 110 hotels. From 12,000 to 500,000 tourists. From one flight a week to 13 flights a day. And they banned mining and banned logging. And the rest of Palawan, which is doing mining, fares nowhere near those kind of economic indicators. In fact, Jerry, I love you, but you know, the poverty level in Batarasa is 53%, you know? And look at this. I really like him, he's a really nice guy. No? Okay, so let me tell you about my own personal experience. I have five projects in Puerto Princesa. Five communities which were very, very poor. And I spent 1.5 million pesos. That's all, $30,000 on dolphin watching, on firefly watching, which by the way won gold in 2010, on snorkeling, on mangroves, and on rock climbing. Just look at my numbers. On the first year, 190,000 pesos. On the second year, 2 million pesos. I already got my money back. On the third year, 3 million pesos, double my investment. You know this Ugong Rock? You know how much the community is earning there now? 15,000 pesos a month. You know how much money they have in the bank? 400,000. Okay, that community, if the kids could go to elementary, that's good. If they go to high school, that's what they call hulog ng langit. Well, on the second year, this community is able to send their kids to college. And they didn't have to do it while destroying the environment. This Iwahig firefly, the banqueros there told me, "Ma'am, hindi ko lang pinapaaral ang anak ko, ako ang nag-aaral." Okay, let me bring you to Kamsur, which went tourism. Their malnutrition rate went down by 45%. From 39, they went to 10. Okay, it's a business and investment hub because of tourism. Okay, finally, let me tell you about the Lojas Market. The Lojas Market is the lifestyles of health and sustainability. And in 2008, when there was an economic squeeze and many companies went belly up and many people lost their jobs, guess what? According to the Natural Marketing Institute, this was the only market that was left unscathed. And in fact, it continues to increase by an exponential 23%. What's the Lojas Market? Ecotourism, green building, personal health. Okay, what am I saying here? I am saying we are not Singapore, we're not Malaysia, we're not Hong Kong. We are 7,000 amazing, gorgeous, beautiful islands, and we can get our people out of poverty if we were to invest in our island ecosystems so that the people there can improve their quality of life by the care of the environment so that they will stop coming here and selling in the streets of EDSA or living in the esteros, why don't we rather invest in our islands? Because that is what God gave us. Okay, in closing, I'm doing really well, 14 minutes. Okay, so in closing, I would like to show you this picture. That's the forested area in the country. That's a protected area. And that, ladies and gentlemen, are mining applications. That's why I get really scared, because the poorest areas... Oh, I need my glasses. Can I give you my glasses? The poorest areas in the country are mining areas. Samar, Surigao, Benguet. So what track record does mining have to speak of anyway? So in closing, I need my glasses. Okay. Can I use your glasses, Arnold? Sorry. So I can't see. I'm already 58 now. Okay. In closing, I would like to say, I'd like to read you this United Nations Declaration. And this just came this week. It says, the natural capital, which comprises Earth's natural assets, soil, air, water, flora, and fauna, and the ecosystem services amount to $3 trillion of U.S. dollars. And according to the United Nations, despite being fundamental to our well-being, their daily use remains undetected within our economic system. Using natural capital this way is not sustainable. The private sectors, everyone else, should recognize the true cost of economic growth and sustaining human well-being today and into the future.
Thank you, Ms. Gina Lopez, for your insightful presentation. Our next speaker